Okay, so let's start. So yesterday we have seen the current mirror, right? And we did some sums also. And in all the sums, what you can see is that we have taken lambda equal to 0, right? That's our assumption. So we are always at lambda equal to 0. Most of the time when we are doing some, but there may be a situation where your lambda is not equal to 0. So what is that situation when lambda will not be equal to 0? CLM is very strong in which, during which region, like saturation, linear or cutoff, it is always present in saturation. So again and again I'm asking you this question so that you are accustomed with this kind of a concept. So CLM is always present in the saturation region of operation, and body bias is something that you may have to deal in all the region of operation. Okay, now yesterday we very bluntly wrote that lambda equal to 0, which is a good assumption when you are looking at large geometry devices, because there your L's are very large, so your delta L by L is also very very small, and then you can say that because of that your lambda is also going to be really very small. But when you are trying to make your devices smaller, that time your lambda is going to come up, or it will become very strong. So if you are assuming it to be like 0.001, in the case of a long geometry device, what it will be in the case of a small geometry device will be slightly like 0.01, or it may also be 0.1. So during such time you cannot assume that lambda equal to 0. So yesterday we saw that we had this kind of a device, like we had a current source here, and then something of this sort. So this is your current source using your NMOS transistor. So this was our IRF M1, let's say M2, drain, source, drain and source, and these are your gate terminals. Current here is going to be IV is always equal to 0, and let's say this is some point VT. So if lambda is not equal to 0, lambda not equal to 0, then we will have to write ID1 is equal to mu n COX W by L 1. Then you can write VGS minus VTO the whole square into 1 plus lambda VDS. So yesterday when we saw, we were making lambda equal to what? 0. So 1 plus 0 is 1, and what remains is only this equation. So we were not even bothering what the value of VDS 1 is. Okay. Similarly, ID again just mu and COX with a small change of W by L 2. VGS minus VTO the whole square 1 plus lambda VDS. Are you understanding it? So when you take the ratio, now lambda is not equal to 0. So you cannot
neglect system. Which term is going to remain? So your current equation will now become something like this. So we have ID1 is equal to ID1 upon ID2 will be W by L1 upon W by L2 into 1 plus lambda VDS 1 upon 1 plus lambda VDS 2.
Now, unless we make VDS 1 equal to VDS 2, we cannot cancel out this term. Do you agree with that? So let's say if lambda is 0.1 also, but if VDS 1 is equal to VDS 2, you can overcome the effect of TL. Do you agree with that? Lambda value can be anything, let it be anything, we say. But if I am able to make VDS 1 equal to VDS 2, then I will be able to get rid of these two terms. So if VDS 1 is equal to VDS 2, I can then write ID 1 upon ID 2 is equal to W by L 1 upon W by L 2. So ID 2 is nothing but I out. So I out is equal to W by L 1 upon W by L 2 on W by L 1 into I. So this formula is only if your VDS 1 is equal to, so it's valid only under some circumstance. And then we say whatever may be the value of lambda, whether it is there or not there, doesn't matter, because anyways these terms are going to cancel out. So the way to make VDS 1 equal to VDS 2 is called as cascoding. Are you understanding? The way to make VDS 1 equal to VDS 2 is nothing but cascoding in the context of a current source. In the context of an amplifier, it is different. Are you understanding? So here, VDS 1 has to be equal to what? VDS 2. channel length modulation. Channel length modulation. causes significant error in copying current. Causes significant error in copying current, especially if minimum length transistors are used. Especially if minimum length transistors are used to minimize width and hence the output capacitance of the current source. So why you may be doing this? Because you may want smaller transistors. Why you may be using smaller geometry devices? Because you might want to reduce the area. That is number one thing. And why you might want to reduce the area? Because W into L is equal to the area, that is the active area, and COX is going to depend on that particular area. Are you understanding? And COX causes delays in the circuit. So if you want your parasitic capacitances to be less, parasitic means unwanted, then it is important that we have smaller geometry devices. So in a way we are saying that make C small, but again there is a whole control theory behind which depends on R and C to set the pole of the amplifier. So we'll see that later on, but in general, if you want to reduce parasitic, then your areas have to be small. But if you try to make your area small, who will come up? It's lambda. Lambda will start becoming not equal to zero. Okay, from equal to zero, it will start becoming not equal to zero, or it will become significant. Right? In the above circuit, VGS1 equal to VGS2. So you can observe VGS1 is equal to what? VGS2. Why? Because they are physically connected. Yes or no? Gate are shorted. Source are also shorted. So very easily we can say VGS1 is equal to VGS2. But this point is also connected here. So we will also say VGS1 is equal to VGS2 equal to VDS1. So right, VGS1 equal to VGS2 equal to VDS1. However, VDS2 may not be equal. However, VDS2 may not be equal to VGS2. May not be equal to VGS2 because of a circuit feed to M2. So we really don't know what we are going to connect here between this point and VDD. Are you understanding? So that thing is something that is unknown, and we may literally connect anything there. So what is our primary objective? We want always VDS1 should be equal to VDS2, then only we can talk about making the transistor small, right? The potential at node P is determined by the input common mode level is determined by the input common mode level, and the gate source voltage of M1 and M2, therefore the potential at this node, may not be equal to node X, So we say the voltage at node X is Vx and the voltage at node Y is Vy. So what is our objective now? We want to make Vx equal to Vy so that this VDS1 will be equal to VDS2, and then even if CLM is there, still the terms will cancel out and there will be no inequality and there will be perfect mirroring, which will be based only on the size of the device, right? In order to suppress the effect of, channel length modulation, a cascode current source can be used. Right. VB is chosen in such a way. So, what you do is now, we will slightly change this circuit so that X is equal to what? Y. Vx is equal to Vy. That's our objective now. Are you understanding? Is the problem very clear to you now? If lambda is present, then we will have to include the value of lambda in the equation of current. But if you include, then there is a issue. The issue is that VDS1 and VDS2 have to be now equal. In the previous case, lambda only was 0. So we were not much worried about the value of VDS. But in this case, lambda is not 0, so we have to account for the value of VDS1 and VDS2. So now what we do is, we want to somehow make Vx equal to Vy, then we can say that the mirroring will be perfect. So what we do is, instead of just one transistor, we put here one more transistor. And then we control the value of VB. What do we control? The value of VB. So you can control the conductivity of this transistor using by voltage what? VB. And in turn, if you are able to control the conductivity of this transistor, it is like controlling the resistance of the transistor. And a variable resistance here could make VDS1 equal to, then the questions are how much should be the value of VB so that this happens. So this is like a first estimate or a first circuit towards making Vx equal to Vy. Draw this circuit. So we'll call this as, we have already M1 and M2. So we'll call this as, let's say another transistor, that is M3. So we can just write that VB is chosen in such a way that VX
is equal to V1, which is like saying VDS1 is equal to VDS2.
So which is the CASCODE device now? This device is called as the CASCODE device. M3 is CASCODE. So all these small questions may be asked to you in the Viva. They may just ask you like, draw a CASCODE current source, why it is required, and so on. Are you understanding? So these things are slightly important. Then they may ask you like, which is, you are saying that this is a CASCODE device or a CASCODE current source. So which is the CASCODE device? So you should be able to say that this device is the CASCODE device. Are you understanding? Apart from the normal current mirror, you are having this as the CASCODE device. Right? Yes. How do we ensure that? With the help of VB itself. So VB should ensure that VDS1 is equal to what? VDS2. That itself means that you are also putting M2 in the saturation. Yes. No, we didn't take M2 in saturation. We don't know. Yeah, so what I did is I used the equation for saturation and then I said that let us use M3 also so that VDS2 becomes equal to VDS1. Now VDS1 is putting, or VDS1, when we are sorting drain and gate, that time M1 is already in saturation. So VDS1 is a voltage which is putting M1 into saturation, and with the help of VB, I am trying to match VDS2 to VDS1, which is a saturation voltage. Yes. 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 So normally what will happen is that whenever you are connecting a circuit here, if you want to use M2 as a current mirror or a current source, M2 has to be in saturation. If I, you mean to say that, see, doubt is a very good doubt. He is asking me that why not use a linear current equation here. If you are using it as a linear current, if you are using a linear current equation there, it means that you are using it as a resistance. You are not using it at all as a current source. So the discussion only ends here. Are you understanding? So you are not at all using the device as a current source. So it should make sure that it might not always be true. It might not always be. So there is something called as a, we say, output voltage swing. So the output voltage swing should not be so high that M2 will come into linear. It has to always remain in saturation. So there are circuits which ensure that this always happens. Okay. And if not, if the output voltage swing becomes too high, so I cannot explain it here. Probably if this is like a slow circuit, so just say this is my input, not VB transistor. And here I have got VDD. So this configuration is a common source configuration. Yesterday we did one circuit. Now I am taking my output here. If you look at the circuit that we had, just go back. We have done a circuit like this yesterday. Yes or no? So I am taking the output from here, this point. Are you understanding? So the voltage swing at this point must not be so high that the condition friction on the output voltage swing, that is also called as voltage headroom, because your output voltage, your maximum is what? VDD. Are you understanding? And the minimum is 0. So VDD is just, let's say, 2 volts or 3 volts for discussion purpose. So 3 and 0. Out of that 3 and 0, some voltage is required to keep this transistor in saturation. So let's say 1 volt is required to keep VDS1 in saturation or VDS2 in saturation. So how much remains? Let's say 2 volt remains. Now you cannot exactly use 2 volts to get the voltage peak. So probably you will be able to use only 1.5 as the net peak to peak voltage peak. But that is enough as far as IC design is concerned, because this chip may be driving a microphone, okay, whose output voltage is not required to be very high. Even something in millivolts is just fine. You will be able to listen to that music very nice. Are you understanding? So even if we get a output voltage swing of just 500 millivolts, that also is enough for us. That's why we have the liberty to make our range small, so that this microphones and all these small speakers can really easily work on this kind of signal. So that's why I am telling you that our voltage range is small. So we are not talking about amplifying from a mic. We are talking about amplifying from a small microphone. Are you understanding? And a very small headphone that you put, whose speakers are very small. So even if you remove it and keep it and just play the song, you will still not be able to hear that song. Only when you put it in your ears, you will be able to listen to it. Right? So we are talking about that kind of technology. Okay? So if you want big amplifiers, then of course you have to move to discrete. You will have to move to discrete. So these problems are there only in analog. So there is always a way to make VDS2 equal to VDS1. And if I make them equal, then also it is like saying, so I know VDS1 is a voltage which is going to put M1 into saturation. So if I am able to match this VDS to this, then we say that, okay, M2 will also be in saturation. And then we say that, okay, the equation that you might have used is correct. Because if you use linear, it doesn't make any sense. First thing, in linear, we don't have CLS. Do you agree with that? So that thing is only gone. So the discussion only becomes void. Okay? Right? I'm just replacing this again back to our normal diagram. So ask questions based on this. Anybody else has a question on this? Please ask. See, your questions are going to help others also. Okay, so it is important that we discuss, and most importantly, it is important to come on time. Yes or no? So I have already told you my mandate for entering the class. So you have to be really very quiet and enter the class. Okay. So any doubts in this? Now the question is, how much should I apply here? Okay. So a first calculation can tell me that, let's say this is one VGS, or VG minus VS will be the VGS of this transistor. Yes or no? And so VB is VGS3 plus VDS2. Can we write like that? Yes or no? So write first before that. The CASCODE device shields the bottom transistor from variations in VP. This implies VY remains close to VX. This implies VY remains close to VX. Hence, ID 1 is almost equal to ID 2. With a higher accuracy. ID 1 is equal to ID 2. With a higher accuracy. However, such high accuracy is obtained at the cost of voltage headroom consumed by M3. So now what you are doing is you are adding a device in series in the current source. So now this also has to be in saturation. This also has to be in saturation. So now you are doubling the devices. So VDS1 as well as VDS3. So we have net how much? VDD. So initially out of VDD we were removing only VDS1. But now you will have to remove VDS1 as well as VDS2. So if I have net 3 and VDS1, VDS2 both are 1 volt. So 3 minus 1 minus 1 will be what? Just 1 volt. That's 3 minus 2. So now my voltage swing can be only 1 volt. So if you cascode more, then you get a very good current source. But then that is at the cost of voltage swing. So voltage headroom is normally the same thing. Okay. It should be noted that while L1 must be equal to L2, the length of M3 need not be equal to L1 and L2. Right. Generation of VB. Since the objective is to ensure VY is equal to VX. Since the objective is to ensure VY is equal to VX. So what can you write? The first equation. So you can write like this. VB is equal to VGS3 plus VY. VB is equal to what? VGS3 plus VY, right? Like this. So this is what you can actually see from the circuit. VB is equal to VGS3 plus VY, which is VDS2 also. Can we write like this? What is our objective now? We want to make VY is equal to VX. So what we will write here is, so VB should actually be VGS3 plus VX. It should be what? VGS3 plus VX. Can we write like that also? Because VX should be equal to VY. Right? Write this equation. So what we see we should write. Okay, and then try to generalize. This suggests that if a gate source voltage, this suggests that if a gate source voltage is added to VX, a gate source voltage is added to Vx, barabar ki nahi, then the required value of Vb can be obtained. Then the required value of Vb can be obtained. This can be obtained by placing another diode connected device. This can be obtained by placing another diode connected device in series with M1. In series with M1. Thereby generating. Thereby generating a voltage thereby generating a voltage, right? VGS 0 plus Vx. I'll call this transistor as M0. So what we wanted is, so this was my Vb, right? Which was what? VGS 3 plus Vy. But what we wanted? Vy to be equal to Vx. So what we said is that we want one VGS extra as compared to Vx. That should be the value of. So what we generated is we put one more transistor here. That will be, so here we will have. So the voltage at this point will be now VGS, this is gate, this source and drain. So this is VGS 0 plus Vx. So instead of relying on a voltage separately from here, what we do is we take, use the mirror circuit itself, which is already there, to give the value of Vb. So draw this circuit now. So this condition Vx equal to Vy is satisfied when W by L 1 upon W by L 2 is equal to W by L 0 upon W by L 3. I'll just call this as point N. Okay. So if you reach this point N from this side and this side, now let's see what happens there. So simple KVL should tell me that voltage at node Vn, okay, is equal to VGS0 plus Vx. Can I write like this? Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay. But VGS is 0 is equal to what? VG0 minus VS0 plus VX. Can we write like this? VGS I can write what? VG minus VS. Okay. Now, if you come from this side, so VS0 is nothing but what? What is VS0? VS0 is equal to VX only, right? Okay. So, can we write like this? If you come from this side, then what can you write? VB is equal to what? VGS3 plus VY. VGS3 plus. So this is going to be VG3 minus VS3 plus VY. So now what is the meaning of that? Here we have VG3 minus VY plus VY. So you can see that this thing gets cancelled out. This is my VG0. So VN is equal to VG0 plus VG0, that is equal to VG3. So that is what we can say, that whatever may be the value of Vx and Vy, we can always achieve this condition. Or conversely, if you achieve this condition, we can say Vx is equal to Vy. Okay. So just some other way of looking at it. But what you can just remember is that this condition will get satisfied if the ratio of M1 to M2 is the same as M0 to M3 or vice versa. So you can write this ratio the other way around also. But don't write it like W by L1 upon W by L0. That would be wrong. Okay. So this is actually the condition to achieve Vx is equal to. Right. Note, this result holds true. This result holds true even if M0 and M3 suffer from body bias. M0 and M3 suffer from body bias. So write one problem that will make things even more clear. Right. In a cascode current mirror circuit, if the reference current source IREF, requires 0.5 volts, require 0.5 volts to operate as a current source. To operate as a current source, what is its maximum value? What is its maximum value? What is its maximum value means what? What is the maximum value of IREF that you can get? So first you draw that diagram, then I'll tell you what to do. Draw the first diagram. Since M2 and M3 are properly ratioed, with respect to M1 and M0, we can assume that Vx equal to Vy. Hence, transistors M1 and M2 are in saturation. So we can write Vx is equal to Vy, that is all the same thing. So the voltage at this point, Vx, is also this, right? Vx. So Vx formula I have given you yesterday. What is that formula? Just check it. It will be root of 2id upon mu n cox w by l, let's say 1 plus Vth, or that Vth is outside the root, okay? Or we'll call it as Vth 1, just for the sake of it. Can we write like that way? Can we write or we cannot write? Okay. So now we have to write here that Vn is equal to VGS0 plus Vx. Now can we also say that this transistor is also in saturation? Yes or no? Its drain gate is also shorted, so that is going to be in saturation. So that is the reason why we can write the same thing. VGS0. So VGS0 will also be what? 2 times of ID upon mu n COX W by L 0 plus Vth 0. Agreed? Now what is given to us is that if you want to operate this current source, the voltage drop across it should be how much? It should be at least 0.5. So in a way they are telling us that VDD minus VN is equal to how much? 0.5. They are telling us this. Do you agree with that? VDD minus VN is equal to 0.5. So now in this case what we can write is, I can substitute this Vx here, and then we can write vn is equal to root of 2id1 upon mu n COX w by l1 plus vth vth0 plus 2 times of id1 mu n COX w by l plus vth1. So here also we should write 0 only. So now everything makes sense. So what can you write here now? How will you write this? So can I write this like this? Root of 2id mu n COX, because all are NMOS transistors, into root of L by W 0 plus root of L by W 1 plus VTH 0 plus VTH 1. Can you write like that? Yes or no? I just substituted Vx in this equation right till here. Now you must understand here that this ID 0 and ID 1, ID 0 is the current flowing through what? M 0, which is also the same current flowing through M 1. Yes or no? And that is equal to what? I ref. So actually this ID 0 and ID 1 are nothing but both are I ref 1. So you can write one line here if you want. ID 0 equal to ID 1 equal to IREF. And now the condition is given to you. This one, VDD minus VN is equal to 0.5. So you put VN in this and write IREF in terms of other term. Come on, do it. Come on, do it fast. So now we have so what will you write now? So IREF is equal to VDD minus VTH1 minus VTH0 minus 0.5 the whole square upon what? All this 2 the whole square. So IREF can be mu n COx by 2. Then you have VDD minus VTH1 minus VTH0 the whole square upon check it whether you are getting this or not. Are you getting this? So IRF is this. So that is the maximum IRF that you will have to keep. So can you calculate the value? Right. Mu n COx is 100 microamperes per volt square. Mu n COx is 100 microamperes per volt square. Then we have VDD, you can take 5 volts. VTH1 and VTH0, both you can take it as 0.4 volts. And L by W, 0, and L by W, 1, you can take it as 2 upon 0.18. Same values you will keep and check what happens. Upon 0.18. So just find out the value of IRF what you get. What is the value of IRF that you get? What is it? How much value do you get here? How much do you get? So IRF 100 into 10 raised to minus 6. Upon 2, 5 minus 0.4 minus 0.4, this is the whole square upon root of 4. 15.4 microamps you are getting that. Okay, so that is the range of current source that you can probably get. So again, can you see here that if you change the ratios of W by L1 and W by L0, you can get the value that you want. So one from this and one from this is going to control the value of the current. Right. Next. So can you do the converse also, can you say that if I give you the current source value Okay, I want a 20 microampere current source. Then can you assume L by W of 1 is equal to L by W of 0? You can assume that and design the value of the, find out the value of L by W of this transistor. I am giving you this now. IRF should be how much? 20. So that's your experiment number 3 actually. That is design of cascode current source. So what I'll do is, my problem statement will be the same. I will give you only the value of the current source, like design a current source of 20 microampere. And design means what? You have to set the values of W by L 1, W by L 0, and then the same W by L 1 and W by L 0, if they are the same, then W by L 2 will be equal to W by L 1, W by L 3 will be equal to W by L 0. So you have to only set those values accordingly. Are you understanding? So it is up to you how you want to set the value. Are you understanding? Yes or no? Okay. So you can do that converse problem in the lab and just do this experiment and find out the value of the current. Now, when you do the experiment, you have to go to something called as spice directive, and there you will write dot model NMOS. So all these NMOS which you are using in the spice model, there you have to write into bracket lambda is equal to 0.1. Introduce channel simulation with this CLM, your IRF should be equal to IR. There should not be much difference between the two. Are you understanding? So once you do this, you should check whether you are really getting it or not. Are you understanding? So that is the thing that you have to check in the lab. First is design for L by W's or W by L's of the transistors using this formula. Then you will go to spice directives, set this dot model and give some value of lambda. So you can vary, you can make it 0.1, you can make it 0.01, or you can make it 0.05. For different values of lambda, your I out should remain equal to IRF. Are you understanding? So that should be always true, so that you check in the lab. Right, next. So have you taken down what you have to do? Right, next one. Band gap reference. Band gap reference. So this is a new concept that you must have not heard before. Okay, right. Analog circuit incorporate voltage and current references extensively. Incorporate voltage and current references extensively. So till now what we have dealt with is only the current source part of it. What we have dealt with? Current. So current source, we have seen, if your devices are big, then you can use the normal current sources. If your devices are smaller, then you will have to go for cascode current sources. Why? Because for smaller current sources, the CLM will become powerful and you will have to deal with it. So cascoding is going to minimize the effect of CLM. Is it all right? So this is all about current source. This much is enough foundation for you to design a current source. Now let's look at band gap references, which are typically not current sources, but they are going to be voltage supplies. They are going to be what? Voltage supplies or voltage sources. Now how to get a voltage supply which does not change with temperature? That is going to be the main thing in the IC, because the IC might get hot. So how to make that independent of a change in temperature, that is going to be the objective. Is it okay? Right? Such references are DC quantities. Such references are DC quantities, which exhibit little dependence on, which exhibit little dependence on supply and process parameters, supply and process parameters, comma, and a well-defined dependence on temperature, and a well-defined dependence on temperature. Right. Temperature independent references. Temperature independent references. So this concept is totally new to you. You have not done this before as such. Okay. So just try and enjoy this particular topic. Okay. So there are some devices in which the output changes if the temperature changes. Now the question is whether it changes linearly or it changes inversely. That is the question. Are you understanding? Which means that if temperature increases, the output also tries to increase. That is one case. And if the temperature increases, the output tries to decrease. That is the second case. So in the first case, when the output tries to increase with temperature, we say that kind of a source is a P-tag, that is proportional to absolute temperature. And if the output tries to decrease with temperature, we call it as a C-tag, that is complementary to absolute temperature. A combination of these two can give us a reference voltage source which is independent of temperature. Okay, so right, concept of VGR. VGR means band gap reference. Now what we are actually dealing with is voltage reference. What we have done till now? Current reference. Now what we are dealing with is voltage references, but voltage reference value depends on the band gap of the material. That is why it is also called as a band gap reference. But what you should understand is that we are not looking at band gap reference is not a kuch aisa alag type ka reference nahi hai. It is what? It is just a voltage reference, nothing else, more than that. So current mirrors and current sources give us current references, band gap references are going to give us voltage reference. Samajh gaya? So what now we are looking at is only voltage. So when we were dealing with current sources, we will normally talk about KCL, because KCL deals with current, Kirchhoff's current law. And when we are dealing with voltage references, we will deal with what? KVL. So simple logic tells me that if I add two voltages, I'll get the net voltage. V1 plus V2 will be some higher voltage V. So if I add a P-tag plus C-tag, then I should get a constant V reference. Okay, because the curves are like this. So right, first one. So normally a P-tag will have this kind of a curve. So let's say this is my voltage and this is temperature. Then we have temperature, voltage, and the voltage can fall with temperature. So So when you get this kind of a response, we call this as a PTAC, this circuit, that is proportional to absolute temperature. Absolute temperature means temperature in Kelvin. Okay, so these words are very fancy, but temperature we always take in Kelvin only, right? So nothing new to us, but it's called as proportional to what? Absolute temperature. So it is called as a PTAC. Then we have got, this is called as what? PTAC. So that is called as complementary to absolute temperature. So this is a PTAC response, this is a PTAC. So if we try to add complementary slope, then we will get a zero slope. Okay, so if this slope is, let's say, plus 1, and if this slope is minus 1, then what we will get is a reference. So that is what we should get. That is the first, we say that's the first cut to this concept. That means there is more to this. Okay, so what we do is, normally if you try to add these responses, so what you should get here is a V zero temperature, and this is my PTAC. Okay, this is what we should get. But do we get it? Okay, so let's see some conditions where this will not be possible. So we'll deal with some values now. Here, so what is the addition of these two? 0.5 and 1.5. What is the addition? 2. Okay. So this is like the exact center of this. So that will be what? 1. So at this point, this white line value will also be 1. And green line value will also be 1. And here, what is happening? This is 1.5. So this is 0.5, and this is going to be 1.5. So at all the three points, your value is going to be 2 only. So here, here, and here. The value is going to be what? 2 only. Do you agree with that? That's a, so here you have, this is a PTAC, and this is a PTAC. But you might have a case like this where is 0.5, this is 1.5, and then you may have here like something like this. So this value is, let's say, 1. So 1 plus 1.5, how much? 2.5. So let's say this is 2.5. And here what will you get? 1.5 and 0.5. So that will be, let's say, 2 volts. And this will be some intermediate value, which you can actually calculate, but forget it. So draw a line, 2 points are sufficient. So can you see, you will get this. This is your VREF. So the first one we can say is constant. This is second one is not constant. It is changing with temperature. So what is the meaning of that? Any PTAT plus any CTAT is not equal to VREF. Any PTAT plus any CTAT is not equal to VREF. We have to balance the slope and then only we will get a reference voltage. Are you understanding? So that is the moral of the story, that just by adding PTAT and CTAT, you will never get a VREF. We have to tweak a parameter which is going to be alpha. So you can just write here, any PTAT plus CTAT not equal to constant VREF. So then what do you do? So how will you generalize this idea now? So if I tell you, draw a block diagram of this, then so right, block diagram of band gap reference. So it is evident that you require one PTAT, right? And then you require one CTAT. But their slopes have to be perfectly complementary. So here you have, let's say, alpha 1, and here you have alpha 2. So let's say the output here is V1, here it is V2. So now what you will get here is alpha 1 V1. Alpha 2, V2. So these are now voltages. One might be proportional to absolute temperature, other one might be complementary to absolute temperature. So if you add these two responses, what you are going to get is VGR. So that is going to be alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2. And VGR is a, this is nothing but a voltage reference. What is it? A voltage reference. Right. If two quantities having opposite temperature coefficient, are added with proper weights, the result displays, a reference with zero temperature coefficient. Okay. For example, if two voltages V1 and V2 vary in opposite directions, with temperature, we choose alpha 1 and alpha 2 such that alpha 1 dt equal to 0. So this is as good as saying V ref is equal to alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2 V2. So if you have to select alpha 1 and alpha 2 in such a way. Right, obtaining a reference voltage, which is given by Vref is equal to, alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2 V2 plus alpha 2 V2. Right, next line. Therefore, we must now identify, two voltages that have, a positive and negative temperature coefficient, So, okay, we have understood that this through graphs it is going to give us this thing, right? But then now the whole point is you have to identify two such circuits at least, one which is a p-tat and the other one which is a c-tat, that's the object, right? Among various device parameters, in semiconductor technologies, the characteristics of BJTs, are most reproducible, and well-defined quantities. And are well defined quantities that can provide positive and negative temperature coefficient, So now, as far as this band gap references are concerned, what are we going to see now? BJTs. We are not we are going to see MOSFETs, but there will be a good amount of BJTs also in the circuit. So these circuits are called as like bi-CMOS circuits because it has, they have got both BJTs as well as CMOS. CMOS meaning NMOS as well as PMOS. So when there is a mixture of all this, we normally call this as bi-CMOS. So there is a, this is a very good book. I can't remember the name. I have uploaded it on our Moodle. So the name of the book only is bi-CMOS technology. So just have a look at the introduction of that book. Means what? What is bi-CMOS technology and where all it is used? That's it. Don't have to look into circuits and all, but just see what it means. Okay. So BGR is one such example of a bi-CMOS circuit. Right. How to make a diode? So now we are trying to build BGR, but then before that we need to see how to make some parts of the circuit so that we can join everything later on. So very often you will be seeing something like this. You will have a reference and we will have one diode which is like this. And please understand, this circuit behaves like a p-type. That's why we are actually observing. But now the question is how to make it, how to make this diode. You can see that this is the p side and this is the n side. So if you want to like make a diode, this is my n and this is my, let's say, p. It's a junction and that you can call it as a diode. But normally N substrate is not grounded. It is connected to what? VDD. And the P substrate is connected to ground. Do you agree with that? In this case, what do you want? N side has to be connected to ground. So we never have a substrate which is going to be this way. We will always start with a P substrate and in that we will build a N well if required to make PMOS transistors. And then go ahead. Why PMOS or why P substrate is a natural choice as compared to N substrate? What is the reason? Why we don't prefer N silicon substrate? Okay, somebody might argue that okay, you are connecting P substrate to ground, na? So what's the problem in connecting N substrate to VDD? Anyways, you have to connect VDD in the circuit, right? Yes or no? But still we don't prefer it. Why? ICT basics. What is that? Yes? No, that's not it. Okay, so just stand up. What's the name? Chetan is saying mobility of electron. Mobility means what? My mobility depends on my neighbor. Yes or no? If nobody is around me, I am free. So how to increase the mobility? You can always make the size of the PMOS three times the size of the NMOS and take care of mobility. So that exactly is not an issue here. In general, we don't prefer. I don't like B division A. Why? If I say like this, then what is the reason? So there might be a problem with the some characteristics of the students in this class. Okay, I'll change the division then. I'll change to B division B because anyways I am not teaching them. So what could be the problem? We are talking about substrates, not about classes. How do you make N substrate? What is the doping impurity there? What is the impurity there? Phosphorus or boron? In N type you are using phosphorus and in P type you are using? So boron is a bigger atom or a phosphorus is a bigger atom? Phosphorus is a, so if you try to dope with phosphorus, silicon, then there is the possibility of crystal defect is more. But when you are using a boron atom, the possibility of crystal defects are less. So in a way, P substrate is much more stable than a N substrate. So that's why we prefer that majority or the base should always be a P substrate. And then you can, if required, you can have a N substrate, N well inside the P substrate. But then that will give crystal defects. So there is a way to get rid of that. What is the way? What is the way? Annealing. So we say RTA is the name of the process, that is rapid thermal annealing. Annealing is just shaking, but thermal annealing is what? Shaking and heating together. So RTA will solve that problem. But if the crystal defect persists throughout the substrate, then probably it's very difficult to get rid of. If everybody is misbehaving, then it is difficult to correct the defect. But if it is one or two, we can always look at them, right? Yes or no? We can or I can look at them. So in general, we prefer what? P substrate, and P substrate has to be grounded. So you cannot use this to make the diode. My natural choice is what? P. Then what I should do? Then what? So I start with what? A P substrate. I start with a P substrate. You want to start with a P substrate. I told you the reason. Okay. In that, I will make a small N well. In that, I make P. And in that, I again make N. But this has to be P plus and N plus. Now, what I can do is, I can connect this point here, and this thing I can connect externally. Sorry, this P substrate is anyways connected to what? Are you understanding? So this is one of the second ways of doing it. So you can have an implant and you can connect it to ground, which is this. Anyway, you have to always make a N well in a P substrate. So naturally, that you are expecting that the diode should be this way. But what happens is that when you connect some positive voltage, this is becoming what? PN. And this so now what happens is this is my this but see something gets. Now you get the unwanted current. This is the unwanted current. P substrate. So the P substrate will become very hot. And then it will also become unreliable. So if the P substrate becomes hot, then it's a problem. So you can't use this also. Okay. So just draw this. Why you can't use, you should know. So making diode is not so simple. Huh? Please mind it. It's not just making one PN, one NO gate diode. Aisa nahi hai. Diode is the most difficult to make. So this is what a diode is like. So this N plus can be considered as a connection to the N well also. And this P substrate is anyways connected to ground. So that I'm not showing, but it is always connected to what? Ground only. But the issue with this connection is that the entire, this current is getting spread out in the entire substrate, which we don't want. We want that the current should be only localized in one particular place so that it does not get associated with the other transistors or the devices on the substrate. So there should be a way. Now this spreading, we don't know. Unless we see a thermal profile of the device, we will not be able to find out how this thing is moving. So then now what we do is, we create one more well. This time it is a P well. In P only, we are creating a P minus. So P is, let's say, normally doped, and P minus is comparatively lightly doped. Okay. So now what happens is that this current instead of flowing into the complete substrate, it moves here like this. And this thing is connected to ground. So now you are able to get this diode, and the leakage current which is causing this unwanted current is also being routed to ground. Are you understanding? So this is actually how you make a diode. So what is here? This is P, this is N, and this is P. So this is which transistor? PNP transistor. Do you agree with that? Out of that, this N well is connected to ground through this N plus. So we say base is connected to ground. And this P is also connected to what? Ground. So in a way, base and collector are connected to ground. So if you look at a PNP transistor, this is my emitter like this. So base is connected to ground and collector is also connected to ground. So instead of this device, what you can do is, now you can use a BJT itself, which is like this. So this is a diode. So you actually make a transistor, connect collector and base to ground, that is going to behave like a diode. Are you understanding? So this is a diode in a substrate. It's not just P and N. So you must have done this in ICT, right? How to make a diode. You're done? That's the basic, right? I think the first device that was taught to you was a diode. And I have only taught you that in ED. Right? So that's how you should make a... But there I could not discuss about this because you had no idea about fabrication. Okay? So this is how you make a diode. Is it all right? So now onwards, instead of a diode, I will always use a BJT. So if you open Razavi, they have directly used this transistor and they are calling it as diode, diode, diode. So many students don't understand ki BJT nikalta hai aur diode kyun bolta hai. Samajh gaya ki nahi? They are drawing a BJT, but it is connected as what? A diode. So all diodes are now BJT. So if you open the book, you should not be surprised why they are calling this as a diode. Is it all right? So we'll see the other part of it next time. That is the actual designing of BGR, and then we'll go to chapter 2 straight up. Okay.